All right, hi everybody. My name is Lexie Hampton, and tonight we will be presenting about period poverty in jails and prisons. So a little bit about me. My major is public policy and I'm on the pre-med track. I don't know why I put sophomore, that's just a lie. I'm a junior. Maybe I wanna pretend that I'm still a sophomore, but the things I'm passionate about, I really like working with other like-minded individuals to make the social change I wish to see, and also watching anime is, it goes like social change and then anime. my favorite thing about the menstrual movement is awareness. This social issue has been neglected for a really long time, and I'm really happy to be a part of an organization and be a part of the process to advocate for change.
And I'm Kathleen. I'm a senior studying computer engineering. And I'm really passionate about helping people with their struggles handling mental health and mental illnesses. And my main like career that I want to go into is called computational psychiatry, where I create AI algorithms and machine learning algorithms to detect biomarkers for different mental illnesses to improve diagnoses and treatments. And my favorite thing about the menstrual movement is donating period products to those who need them. That's what really like got me to fall in love was my first year like on the e-board last year. I was in charge of giving period products to those who needed them, and just seeing them like be so happy was like, wow, like this is what it's all about. It's just making others happy. So I'm going to start us off by telling you a bit about the jails and prisons in America. So the current criminal justice system is actually very unjust, and most of those who are incarcerated actually need help and are not, they shouldn't be in a jail cell. They could use therapy, counseling, or other means. And the types of people who can sometimes be incarcerated include those who are addicted to drugs. And in fact, more people incarcerated today for drug offenses alone is higher than the sum of total offenses that happened in 1970. And also there are human trafficking victims that often get their case to be misunderstood, and they will be charged for defending themselves against, you know, their traffickers, and sometimes even charged with prostitution, even though it was against their will. And there's also people, you know, who have stolen food, money, and other things to provide for themselves and families. And it's been proven that our justice system really villainizes those who don't have the means to protect themselves. They can be victims of abuse. They can be victims of, you know, different systems, not having enough money and things. And also on the right, I have two graphs showing that America has 5% of the world's population, but 25% of the world's prison population. So 1 in 4 people in the world who are in prison are in America. And you can also see to the right about drug offenses, how they have increased from 1980 to 2018 because of the war on drugs. And then there's another issue is life without parole. So currently there are 108,000 women in the US who are in prison, and 7,000 women, 1 out of 15 of total incarcerated women, are sentenced to life without parole. And on the bottom left, you can see a graph showing how those given, you know, life without parole sentences have increased and don't see like any sign of stopping. And to the right, I have a video showing an example of the types of victims who are given life without parole.
Do 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 do. Oh. Oh, gotta love technological errors.
Darn. Maybe we can. You know, yeah, like maybe we can just click the clip link.
Yeah. In school, I excelled. I was on the honor roll and the principal's honor roll, and I was like an overachiever. I ran track, I ran for student body president. I wrote a book on drugs and its effects, and I won a Young Authors Award. Gigi would start to take me or my little friends to roller skating or to the mall and stuff, and everything. And he was like a father figure. Gigi was there at some times. And he would talk to me and take me out and like give me all these lavish gifts or do all these things for me and stuff. And then he would tell me that sex-wise, he said, you don't need to give it up for free. He would try to put in my head all these different things and how men really think and how men are. And so I would believe him. He had sex with me when I was 13. And he's a very... he uses his manhood to hurt, like break you in, I guess. Gigi's hours were from 6 in the evening to about 5:30 to 6 in the morning. The girls would bring their money and give it to him. He was like married to all of us, I guess. That's just how they do. Everything was his.
Going to cut that right there. Any thoughts on that video before we move on?
Yeah, that's whack.
Yeah.
I don't understand how there's not a law that protects those people. Like, obviously self-defense is a thing. So it's just so frustrating and incomprehensible to me to like fully understand how judges can see these women, hear their stories, and then sentence them to life. And she was a minor at the time. She wasn't even like tried as a child or anything.
Right.
Like without prison, without parole, and 4 years. Like, what's the 4 years for?
That's just disrespectful.
Literally.
Yeah. It's really sad. Okay. So now I want to get into racism a little bit. And let's see, I feel like this video is gonna do the same thing. Yep. Kathleen. Okay, I guess we'll just have to skip that one for now. Okay, so we're gonna get into the section about what period poverty is. And period poverty refers to the inadequate access of menstrual hygiene tools and educations, including but not limited to sanitary products, washing facilities, and waste management. And what does period poverty have to do with inmates? It all stems down to four major themes that I broke into. It starts with inaccessibility, unhygienic conditions, abuse of power, and stigma.
If that doesn't work, try clicking, like escaping and clicking the share button, like when you press play. You see those three dots? And then, yeah, copy that link.
Nice.
Yeah.
Well, if that's the case, then we'll just go back and watch the other video really quick.
I don't know if it'll do the same because, oh, maybe, yeah. There you go.
Sorry for the technical difficulties, y'all. Okay, let me just see what the timestamp was really quick. Skippy, skippy, skippy. Almost there.
Hell, 6x9, living hell, stone wall, metal balls for the guards in jail. My nickname, the can, the slammer, the big house. I'm the place many fear, cause there's no way out again.
Bureau of Justice reported that one in three young black males is expected to go to jail or prison during his lifetime, which is an unbelievably shocking statistic. Black men account for roughly 6.5% of the U.S. population. They make up 40.2% of the prison population.
Now have more African Americans under criminal supervision than all the slaves back in the 1850s.
The prison industrial complex relies historically on the inheritances of slavery.
13th Amendment says no involuntary servitude except for those who have been duly convicted of a crime. So once you've been convicted of a crime, you are in essence a slave of the state.
The stroke of a pen is not self-enforcing. And so while the 13th Amendment is hailed as this great milestone for freedom and abolitionists celebrate, and you know, this is the end of a lifelong quest, the reality is much more problematic. Well, once that clause is inserted in there, it becomes a tool. It's there, it's embedded in the structure. And for those who seek to use this criminality clause as a tool, it can become a pretty powerful one because it's privileged. It's in the Constitution. It's the supreme law of the land.
Throughout American history, African Americans have repeatedly been controlled through systems of racial and social control that appear to die, but then are reborn in new form tailored to the needs and constraints of the time. You know, after the collapse of slavery, a new system was born, convict leasing, which was a new form of slavery. And once convict leasing faded away, a new system was born, a Jim Crow system that relegated African Americans to a permanent second-class status. And here we are, decades after the collapse of the old Jim Crow, and a new system has been born again in America, a system of mass incarceration that once again strips millions of poor people, overwhelmingly poor people of color, of the very rights supposedly won in the civil rights movement.
And so instead of talking about...
All right, we're going to cut that one right there. Any thoughts about that video before we move on? I know I personally have seen that documentary like 3 times. I know you have too, Danny. We often watch it together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it just really blows my mind how some people, specifically, not to get personal, but my parents can like see all this stuff and like all of this and then still just like completely be ignorant to it.
Yeah.
And like, it's and the intersectionality of it too, like, I know they mostly discuss black men, but like black women are also disproportionately arrested, victims of police brutality. And I don't know if there's statistics of it, but just because of the society that we live in, I'm assuming black women are not treated very nicely in prison either. So, and that doesn't even get into black trans women. Oh my God.
Just an endless vicious cycle. Of
literally.
Oops. Okay. Google. No. Neat. Okay. There we go. All right. So now we're going to watch this video really quick. We got a lot of good clips going on today. And this one gets into period poverty in prison specifically.
Talking to decision. And hygiene product, but went viral. It shows a female inmate and she appears to have no pants on. The woman's attorney claims that the jail refused to provide proper clothing and hygiene products. The district court judge ordered clothes be brought over before resuming the hearing and then apologizes to the inmate, calling the incident, quote, outrageous.
So I just want to tell you how incredibly sorry I am that you've been treated this way. No one deserves this. The rest of this is completely inhumane and unacceptable. And I'm very sorry that you had to go through this.
The jail claimed it was a mistake. For more on this topic, we're going to pick up our conversation with Topeka Sam. She says access to hygiene products is far from sufficient while behind bars, oftentimes leaving women to make a very difficult decision.
I think something that a lot of women would relate to is, like you were talking about, it costs $4 to make a phone call to your kids, and it costs $5 to buy a box of pads. Do women often have to choose between talking to their children and buying feminine hygiene products?
Absolutely. Am I going to talk to my child this week? You know, you do have the opportunity to go to commissary in most places weekly. But again, if you're making $5 a month, you only have one choice, right? And then what do you do? You know, it puts you in the situation of having to survive. And most people who are incarcerated because of poverty, right? So when you look at a person who's already criminalized because of their poverty, then they go into incarceration and then they have to decide whether or not they're going to choose to call their children or buy a box of pads or tampons. What do you think a person is going to do within the prison system? So it's this mindset that consistently goes to survival, but no one is giving you the things that you need to heal and really understand the transition, both spiritually and emotionally. And so it's incredibly difficult. And then we haven't even touched on the children.
Any thoughts about that one?
This is being recorded. I'll be less vulgar. I just think it's so crazy how they profit from people in jail like mm-hmm. that. How it costs money to call your child. It costs money for pads.
Mm-hmm.
The government and these prisons, which are mostly private prisons, who make a ton of money, they do not need these inmates to be paying for this stuff in order to get it. They could most 100% certainly, you know, pay for phone bills. The prisons can, pads they can pay for, any sanitary products. Same thing as like toilet paper and all that. And I don't know to the extent of which, how much they have to pay for in there. But if you're having to pay for phone calls and pads, I can't even imagine for like stuff that wouldn't be deemed necessary. And the fact that, and that just blows my mind that not only is the prison using you for basically free labor, if, like she said, it's true, it's $5 a month, or even if it's something, anything less than it, like a minimum wage is basically free labor on the part of the prison, because they're making money off of these products. Anything that these prisoners are doing for labor or making is definitely worth more than the $5 that they're paying them for.
Mm-hmm.
And it's consistent. It's day in, it's day out. It's not like people can take time off or just like not show up to whatever they're doing. And it's just so bamboozling to me how they can just so plainly be so inhumane to all these people and just be like basking in the money from it, of all the profits.
Yeah, I truly don't know how people live with themselves knowing that they are putting people through this kind of mistreatment and just in just like a complete disregard for their humanity. And that's something that we'll definitely get into moving forward with the presentation. I don't know how to go to the next slide. Here we go. Okay. So to start with inaccessibility, a lot of prisons and jails have product shortage and they will often withhold menstrual products so that inmates are forced to use unsanitary substitutions. And those can be things like napkins, socks, tissues, cloth, ripped up piece of paper, like anything they can find, really. And when distributing these sanitary products, inmates are often only given a handful of pads to last the duration of their cycle. And you know, we already know that that is just not sustainable because every body is different. Every menstruator's cycle is different and have like different flows according to their bodies. And that's just not being considerate of that. And additionally, some jails and prisons will put a cap on how many menstrual products an inmate can receive per month. And if an inmate were to come forward and request more menstrual products, they are often put through medically unnecessary health screenings, pelvic exams, and psych evaluations. And furthermore, there's also a contraband rule where, you know, as we were saying, that these private prisons, like their only goal is to make profit. And if inmates get more resourceful and like, you know, make their own products instead of buying these ones from the commissary, you know, that would put a dent in their profits. So that's why they would view this as contraband and these objects would be subject to confiscation. And then another thing regarding inaccessibility is inadequate wages and overpriced products. On average, prison laborers make between 86 cents and $3.50 a day. And, you know, that's average. So of course, people could be making lower than that as well. And tampon prices are inflated. They can be like $7 to $11 for a small box. And sometimes, you know, a box of 20 will have to be shared between like 13 inmates. And kind of going off of prison labor, like wages, I think I saw a statistic where a 12 box of tampons would cost 21 hours worth of labor from an inmate in order to purchase that. And that's not even accounting for like other things they need to buy, like, you know, food, more clothes, razors, soap, shampoo. And, you know, sometimes there's not enough money in their budget for all of these products. And since a lot of inmates are coming from poverty when they enter prison, you know, they don't have a backup plan or they don't have people or family members who are able to give them money. And even for the inmates who do have or who are fortunate enough to have a family member send money to them, you will often have a cap of how much money you can spend at commissary. So you couldn't buy like 3 boxes of tampons because, oh, that exceeds the limit, you know. So just little things like this in order to establish that power and control. And additionally, there's also transgender discrimination. On top of being forced into a prison that does not coincide with their gender identity, transgender individuals are subjected to high levels of violence, sexual assault, and discrimination. And there wasn't a whole lot of statistics on this, so I'm kind of just assuming, but I would say that all male prisons likely do not provide menstrual products at all. And if a transgender individual was to request a menstrual product, they would likely be subjected to more ridicule, more violence, more humiliation from their peers, which is a whole other can of worms. And then additionally, there's also a lack of consistent protocol with prisons. And as of 2019, there are 38 out of 50 states that don't have a law requiring prisons to provide menstrual products. And even though like some of these states do have a law, oftentimes the law just says to make them available. And available is a very subjective term because for some people, like availability means providing extra toilet paper, which just, you know, goes to show the lack of education about menstruation and what, you know, materials people need. But there is some legislation in the works. There is the Dignity for Incarcerated Women Act introduced by Cory Booker, Elizabeth Warren, and Richard Durbin, which would compel the Federal Bureau of Prisons to provide free hygiene products to inmates. However, while that would establish change on a federal level, that's not accounting for state prisons because they are state private prisons have their own jurisdiction and they don't have to abide by state level or federal level laws. So like the work doesn't stop there. Just because they are currently working on something at a federal level, like it needs to go all the way down the chain. So moving on to hygiene. Living conditions vary from prison to prison, but people are usually provided soap, a toothpaste. Sometimes they're provided shampoo or toothbrush and toilet paper, but products are almost always cheaply made and ineffective. And I've seen a lot of videos where You know, when people are laboring all day long and they try to go and shower, they feel like they can never get clean because the soap doesn't do anything, the deodorant doesn't smell like anything. They often won't get conditioner, they'll just get shampoo. And if you've ever like had shampoo, what that does is just dry your hair out and like make it like curly and frizzy. So without having conditioner to like balance that, it can harm your hair. And inmates are typically only allowed to do laundry once a week. And this can cause an issue in the event that you're on your menstrual cycle and you bleed through your clothes and you aren't provided the spare. You have to basically just exist in your soiled bloody clothes until you're able to do laundry the following week. And some facilities don't provide proper clothing like underwear. So even if you have say a pad, if you don't have underwear to put it to, I don't know if anybody has ever tried to like stick a pad to just like pants, it just doesn't work. It'll slip and it's just not effective. And especially if the products themselves already are ineffective, like that's just, you know, makes it worse. Following that, menstrual hygiene itself, menstrual product availability is different in each facility. Oftentimes there are not enough that are provided and people have to resort to making their own or resort to unsanitary means. So we are going to click on this link real quick to see how to make a prison tampon.
Hi, you guys. I am going to show y'all today how to make a jailhouse tampon out of a pad and a comb. Now, a lot of times you got fluffier pads and they do work better, but most of the time this is what kind I got. These yellow Equate brand was what they had in the jail I was in. So I want to try to show y'all how to do this. I'm out of practice, but here we go. I'm going to try and do it quick since I'm going to have this video in real time. What you're going to do, you don't need no use for that. I'm going to stick this. I'm going to leave that on there. Okay. And then we are going to rip the end here. Off this top layer because that is your most important piece. The fluffier pads do work better. Okay, so this is what we got going on here. And then you're going to take this cotton part, and this is going to be the inside of your tampon. And if you got a fluffier pad, it works better because you can literally go like this and it fluffs up the cotton. But if you're using one of these little thin suckers, then pretty much just have to pick it apart. Or you can actually just roll it. So, here we're going to take some of your cotton and roll this up. So, and put this in here. Kind of do it at a slant so that you can get a long tail. And you want to do it to where no cotton is going to come out. So I always like to do like a, make sure it's all safe and no little fringes are out the part that, you know, goes inside of you. So pull up like that and roll it up. Literally just do this, tie it up. This kind of makes your string here. And that right there. And that's all you gotta do. And then you just insert it, and this little part right here comes out. Just like I said, make sure not.
And yeah, that's how women in prison have to make tampons. Any thoughts about that video?
One, I'm kind of glad we watched that because I feel like that's just like a kind of a good survival skill to have in case, you know, you have pads but not a tampon.
Yeah.
But two, it's so unfortunate that women have to do that just so that they can have a tampon. And three, it just blows my mind because I don't know, I feel like there are so many health risks by, you know, making your own tampon and inserting it yourself. And like, the fact that it's not like fully, like it's, yeah, there's cotton in it, but it's not like manufactured the way that tampons are that are meant to like make sure no extra tissue falls off, to make sure that it's absorbent enough, to make sure that, you know, you're fully, it's, the string is strong enough to pull it out later. Cause like, what if the string, like it's just paper. So I feel like as somebody who has a deep fear of getting like septic shock or, is that the one where your like fingers fall off?
Septic? I think that's when your organs die.
I was thinking of the one that could happen. Huh?
Toxic shock.
Yeah, maybe that's it. Yeah. That can happen. So like that's always been like a big fear of mine. So like the fact that women have to do that and, you know, risk those things like on a weekly or monthly basis, I guess, is really messed up.
Yeah, definitely. Any other thoughts? All right, I'll carry on. So a lot of these poor living conditions and lack of menstrual product availability is due to menstrual misconceptions. Many correctional officers don't understand how menstruation works due to a lack of education and stigma. So they will deny inmates products based on their own misconceptions. You know, I watched a lot of videos where a woman would say, hey, like I ran out of pads, could I please have a couple more? And the correction officer would like get upset and say, well, I gave you two pads yesterday, why do you need more? Type of thing, you know, not taking into account that usually two pads will last 6 hours at most. So relating back to menstrual hygiene, resorting to unsanitary methods or using their own products, as you mentioned, Danny, can lead to a lot of health complications. And these health complications can include like urinary tract infections, reproductive tract infections, bacterial vaginosis, yeast infections, and actually do believe it can lead to sepsis and will cause your organ failure and you will die. And it can also lead to infertility. So another factor behind period poverty in jails and prisons is abuse of power. Prison guards often are not supervised and they're not regulated by anybody. And even if they are found doing something they're not supposed to be doing, they'll face very little consequences for that behavior. So they're able to subject inmates to unwanted sexual advances and punish them with solitary confinement or obstruction of hygiene products or, you know, other products that they need. Or even like making a call home for denying their demands. So they coerce people into doing what they want, just holding over, like holding power over them, over something that they can't control, I guess. And then, so this lack of supervision and like power balance with the guards leads to inhumane treatment of inmates. Inmates are stripped of their individuality. They are overworked, underpaid, subjected to mental, physical, emotional, and sexual abuse. And on the topic of that, a lot of inmates come into prison with a past history of trauma or mental illness or, you know, some kind of condition where they need help or they need more consideration, just, you know, and guards are not considerate of this. They will be as brutal with them as with any other people, as they should not be, but as they do. And this can lead to a lot of behavioral issues that will lead to more punishment. And, you know, the fact that solitary confinement is a punishment at all is, you know, a very terrible, inhumane thing. People are social creatures. And when they, on top of being, you know, stripped of who they are and, you know, forced to do hard labor, and all these other factors, it can lead to a lot of psychological damage, depression, anxiety, and stress. And this all kind of ties into stigma. You know, the reason why we have period poverty, why we have like mistreatment of menstruators, it all stems from a lack of education and systemic gender-based oppression. This lack of education is what fuels misconceptions, myths, and false information about menstruation. And raising awareness and advocating for change at the policy level and beyond is crucial to ending the stigma, as this video will kind of touch on. One moment.
At the same time, I would say education and raising awareness is the link to making systemic change. In complete honesty, I don't think that nonprofits and what I'm doing right now as a nonprofit leader is making long-term change. Because I realize that at the end of the day, if my organization disappeared and our direct services stopped, in 10, 20 years from now, those same people probably won't have access to period products, right? For me, I do think that the long-term goal of changing, making systemic change is to change the system itself through policy. But I realize, that in order to do that, we have to pass legislation that gets period products in schools, in shelters, in prisons, repeals the tampon tax, gets things like the food stamps to cover period products as necessity, which they currently don't. But I've met so many people who work in policy and legislators, and it becomes apparent to me that we cannot change and pass that policy until we change culture, until we get those legislators even comfortable to say periods or tampons on the House floor, right? Until we can get constituents to know that when they see a tax code about period products, they know what that means, right? So for us, my end goal is not about periods. My end goal is about gender equality. And I just know that we have to address periods to get to gender equality. And in order to do that, we need to pass this policy, and the link to get there is education and raising awareness. Mm-hmm. Yeah, very well.
I think that video literally just encompasses everything that we could possibly say about period poverty. Love it. Any other thoughts on it?
I cannot believe menstruational products are not like in food stamps and stuff like that. Like, I get it's not food, but like, yo, it's a necessity. It just baffles my mind. And also the fact that, like, not to generalize men, but that men have such a poor understanding of the menstrual cycle or like anything that involves it just blows my mind. And I remember, you know, going through elementary and middle school, they would always separate the boys when it's time for, like, you know, the girls. And it's like, I get it makes them uncomfy, but like, you can't hand a woman two tampons and call it cool for like the next week. Like, and then, you know, or like that woman, the first woman astronaut, they gave her 100 tampons and they were like, is this enough for you? Like, are you going to be good for those 5 days up there that you're going to be up there? And that was NASA.
Yeah, it's really, I meant to mention this earlier when I was talking about protocol. Whenever people take the initiative to go on the House floor and present legislation, the moment people say period, like half of the representatives just leave. And, you know, of those half, they're men, of course. And this funny part of a video was like, well, if I ever want to just make period change, all I have to say is the word tampon and, you know, everyone's leaving and then I can just get it passed. And wow, that is super unfortunate that, like, you know, even the leaders of our country can't handle the word period, tampons, and, you know, all that goes into a menstrual cycle and all that. It's crazy to me.
But No, I was just going to say, I was thinking about, like, will this stigma, like, lessen in the future? Will this get better by the time, like, AOC runs for president or, like, anybody else? Like, will it be better? But then I think about it and I, like, talk to so many guys who, like, if the word period comes up or tampon or anything, they get super uncomfortable. And if it's, like, I'm very grateful for my boyfriend because sometimes I'll be like, what misconceptions do you have? Or like, what are stories? And he'll tell me some of the craziest things. And I'll be like, that's what, like, people think? Like, it blows my mind. So I really hope that one day the stigma will lessen and like education will, you know, progress. But unfortunately, I don't really see that happening for a while. You know, I feel like if you try to make the boys in school learn period information, like there'll be a bunch of angry parents who are like against it or anything like that. And anyway, sorry, that was just a rant, but I just hope things get better.
No, it's really true. And like she said in this video, before you can change period poverty and policy and all that, you have to change culture and you have to change like the social, you know, perception of what menstruation is and, you know, all of that. It's not just a one-step process. All right, so now ways to how we can help. Kathleen, you want to take this one?
Yeah, so as mentioned earlier, a lot of the times people who get incarcerated are already victims of abuse. And when they get put in this criminal justice system, it, you know, furthers their abuse that they've already experienced. And finding friends like while in jail or prison is not very easy. So, and they will definitely be missing their loved ones, they'll be missing their friends and their family, because they can't, you know, call them up whenever they want to. They can't, you know, talk to them whenever or have them visit them whenever. It always is on the times allowed by the facility that they're staying at. So one way that we can help is by easing their loneliness, by writing them letters, or by doing a video call, you know, just saying like, how are you doing? And just talking about each other's day, acting, you know, normal, just being a nice person to talk to brighten their day. And if you're interested, on Mondays from noon to 1 p.m., this nonprofit called Let's Get Free hosts Zoom calls to write letters. And I put the link to the Zoom call right there that they use every week. And on this link from Let's Get Free, they have a list of pen pals who, you know, people who are incarcerated and looking for pen pals, and also tips for writing to people in prison. And for Valentine's Day, which was now 4 days ago, they had an event where people who are incarcerated were requesting to receive Valentine's, and that's what that Google Doc is for. And for the video calling is called Operation Breaking Bread. And there is a Google form for filling out if you're interested in that.
And this slide formatted weirdly, but some other ways that you can help is contacting your representatives. You hold a lot more political power than you think, in that most people know. Your representatives need you if they want to keep their jobs. So like a very important thing of theirs is to advocate for the issues that their constituents care about. And if their constituents aren't bringing this issue to their attention, you know, most of them, that just flies right over their head, you know. So other ways you can help are you can fundraise and donate. I've listed a couple places here that accept donations. And you can also research and spread awareness to end the stigma and engage in research. As I was putting together this presentation, I had a very hard time finding statistics. And that's because this is such just like a very issue that has no attention, no spotlight on it. So a lot of people don't know or don't care to know about what's going on in prison because of their own misconceptions about, oh, well, they're in prison. So, you know, their quality of life isn't my concern because whatever they did to get there, they deserve, you know, and we all know that's not true. And other ways that you can help are sign petitions to ban private prisons, enforce free period products for those who are incarcerated. And you can advocate for the reintroduction of the Dignity for Incarcerated Women Act. And all of these are linked in the presentation that we can share with everybody later, I believe. And yeah, thank you all for attending. Does anybody have any questions?